Based on your questions from my last video on the new legalize option on the Ninja 5, mixed with the requests I receive from time to time asking how to set up the Ninja 5 with X camera, I've decided to make this rapid fire Ninja 5 setup guide. Let's get undone.
Gerald Undone. He's crazy.
What's happening, everybody? I'm Gerald Undone, and I move naturally at 24 frames per second. Okay, so let's jump right into this guide, and let's start with the input tab, because I first want to address the many questions I had on the previous video regarding the behavior of the new legalized toggle. And if you have no idea what I'm talking about right now, that means you didn't see the last video on the 10.3 firmware update for the Ninja 5, and you should probably go watch that now. Okay, so make sure that you don't have any of these other buttons pressed, because otherwise we can't access the red menu. For instance, if you have the yellow button pressed, then it's a yellow menu. So take any of those off, press the red menu button, and we'll start on the input tab. Now, this is where a lot of you were having problems, because I was showing you, look, you can turn legalize on and off. And some of you were saying comments even like, well, that's because you're not even shooting in log. And I think there's a lot of misunderstanding here about how the Ninja actually works with the camera, because I also get questions all the time asking if I can record 444, if I can record 10-bit, if your camera doesn't support it. And it's important for you to realize that the Ninja doesn't change anything about the camera. So it doesn't really matter what buttons you press on the Ninja, it doesn't make your camera shoot in log or not shoot in log or shoot in 10-bit or 8-bit. None of that's gonna be the case. So my camera is in log, and it was in log yesterday when I was demonstrating this. And regardless of what you press on the Ninja, it's not gonna change that. So this little toggle here that many of you were confused about, which says log/HDR, turning that on and off doesn't put anything into log. And it's actually just for HDR processing. And I think this seems to be the most common confusion about this. Now, yes, you are correct that if you turn that on, the legalize option that I was just talking about in my last video goes away. But that's okay, because what this is for processing HDR directly in the Ninja 5. It was actually, you know, like a proud thing. They were talking about like Atom HDR and all that stuff when it came out. It's basically to save time so that if you just wanted to set this up, record it that way, and then put it in Final Cut, your HDR workflow is already mostly done. But if you're just trying to capture whatever the camera's putting out, you don't need this. In fact, I wouldn't even turn that on because it's just a waste of time and it adds confusion and it disables things like the legalize option. But let's talk about those toggles a little bit. So the one over on the left and the one over on the right, if you press the one on the right, it tries to figure everything out for you automatically, HDR auto. If you turn that off, you can turn this on, and then you have to manually dial in what you're sending it. Again, this doesn't control anything on the camera. This is up to you to input what the camera is sending. So right now we've got Sony, S-Log2, and S-Gamut. And this doesn't do anything to the image. In fact, it's gonna be difficult for you to see, but if you can kind of observe the image around the outside as I turn it off and on, you might notice a slight flash as we turn it off and on, but once it settles, it returns to the exact same image. And I've done tests by recording this on and off in different settings, and all the outputs are exactly the same once you record them. But what it does do is enable some options in this monitoring menu. So if we go over to the monitor tab here, you see how we have native and LUT? I have a LUT on right now. Let me turn that off so you can see what the looks like natively. Okay, so we have native and we have LUT. And if we go back to the input menu and we turn this on and then go back to the monitoring menu, it might be a little bit confusing because you're like, why do I have to jump back and forth between two different menus to actually see what it does? But that's how it works. Now we have Rec 709, HLG, and PQ. And these are ways to process the image already in the Ninja 5. So when you record it, they're processed and done, and then you can deliver them that way. Or you can even probably deliver them out of the HDMI port for broadcast. So you've got Rec 709, which obviously gives you a much more contrasty finished image. You've got HLG, which is designed for HDR. And then we've got PQ, which is the same thing, depending on if you're in HDR, you know what these are. If you don't plan on doing HDR workflows, again, you can ignore them. But those are your different HDR image processing. And in case you don't believe me, because some of you were quoting the manual and you also seem to have some confusion about that, I'm gonna read right from the latest Ninja 5 user manual. If you go down to the video input section, which is where we were over here, and you read the camera output part, which is the thing along the bottom, it says, for the best image processing results, it is essential to match the Ninja 5 settings to the camera input settings. This is what you guys were quoting when you asked me, I thought we were supposed to turn that on. But if you move over to the log HDR explanation here, it says, turn on to enable HDR image processing inside the Ninja 5, bring the control of post into your shoot, record, preview, and review using HDR. So that's what it's for. And if you want to record the file exactly as it's coming out of the camera, if you want to record the same thing that your camera would record internally, the SD card, turn that off. Or you can turn it on and set it to native, but why have it on? Because now when it's off, you can turn on legalize, and that gives you the benefit of the what the whole previous video was about. And if you have it off, well, now the Ninja 5 is going to record the exact same thing that the camera would record internally to the SD card, but then you introduce those problems where you can't monitor correctly, and the Ninja thinks that it's a legal range when it's not. Again, watch the previous video. But hopefully that's an answer to that. That was causing some confusion. You only turn that on if you plan on doing in-Ninja HDR processing or Rec. 709 processing. But if you just want to capture what your camera's normally doing, just leave it on off. That's my best advice for that. Now let's move through some of the rest of the tabs, and I'll give you some general tips of how I set things up to make it easier. So in the output tab, we have a few other options. Right now I don't have an HDMI cable coming out of the output, but this is where you could choose if you wanted to scale it down. So if you wanted 4K coming out, or if you wanted to scale down to 1080 or change that, you could do that. Also, you can enable your HDMI timecode option there. Also down here, you have HDR options so that the HDMI that's coming out, you can make that HDR broadcast ready delivery as well, and you'll have the same options between like HLG and PQ and that kind of thing. If we go to the record tab, this is where you set your codecs, obviously. I'm using DNX. If you don't have this option available, it's because you didn't activate it. You only get ProRes, but if you want to use DNX, you have to activate the device, and then it unlocks the DNX mode. It doesn't cost anything, but it's just an extra step. A lot of people ask me about the different quality options, like which one should I use for which purpose. What I would recommend is looking at the data tables for the different, whether it's ProRes or DNX, and it will show you the different bit rates and different quality. The most common question is whether standard ProRes is enough, or if you should use the higher quality one, or if the lower quality one is fine. I would say that if you're doing YouTube or anything like that, standard quality or even the LT version, whatever it's called, is probably fine. You don't need the higher quality one. But space is kind of cheap these days, so if you want to preserve these files as like masters, then I'd probably do the higher quality one, because on a 1 terabyte SSD, you still get like 3 hours of runtime. So it's up to you, but no, you don't need the highest quality for like an 8-bit YouTube output. You're not really going to see a difference. Let's move on to the file tab. Now there is something new here in the latest firmware, which I didn't mention in the previous video, which is that instead of scene shot take, you can change to rolling scene shot take. For the most part though, you can't really do any damage in here. Just set this up however you want your files to be recorded. Nothing to really worry about there. Okay, now meters. Now this tab does have some things that can go wrong for you. I've had some people tell me that they're not getting audio from their camera into their Ninja via HDMI. And as you can see when I talk, you see how we've got levels here coming on track 1 and track 2? If you enable too many tracks, which you can do by pressing record, and or if you enable the analog, what might happen, these are prioritized from left to right, and some programs will only start playing the first tracks in your track list automatically, so track 1 and 2. So if you have analog turned on, analog refers to the microphone inputs on the device itself. So if you have a microphone connected to the Atomos, you need analog turned on and you'll see these levels go. But if you're bypassing audio from your camera into the Ninja, it's actually best if you turn those off, because otherwise they'll write to track 1 and track 2, and then you might not even hear your audio. So instead, it'll go now 1 and 2 from the camera is the priority recording, and then you'll hear it. So I would turn off analog if you're bypassing audio. And this will work regardless of your configuration on the camera. So right now I don't have a microphone connected to the camera, so what we're picking up here is just the in-camera microphone. But if I attached, say, a shotgun microphone to the camera and then connected to the microphone in, well, now that's what would come through there. Basically, however you have your camera set up, that's the audio that's going to go through and into that. Or another way of looking at it is, if you plugged your headphones into the camera and listened to that, that's what's getting transmitted over HDMI. And that'll generally come through on track 1 and 2 there. So press record on that to enable it. And if you press the headphone button above it, that will make the headphone port out on the Atomos. That's what channel you're monitoring. Also, for that same problem I mentioned earlier about some players getting confused, I would leave audio embed set to off. There's a bit more to this. If we jump over to the audio tab, these two, left gain and right gain, are for controlling the input volume of the microphone that you connect directly to the Ninja. If you're connected to the camera, again, these are irrelevant, and you want to control the gain on the camera itself, and that will control how loud the signal coming over HDMI is. So you don't control it here. Also, same with the input here, where it says mic level or line level. That, again, is for the device that's connected directly to the Ninja. However, the audio delay does do something. And if you're recording from a Sony camera, I think pretty much all of the recent gen ones, A7 III, the A6600, And even with other Atomos devices, like the Shogun 7, for example, they're all the same. You want to put a two-frame delay for the Sony cameras. It might be different for different cameras, like your Panasonic might require something different. But that's basically when you're routing the audio over HDMI, there's a difference between how quickly the audio is being processed and how quickly the video is being processed. And I found in my experience, it's about a two-frame delay. So if you set that to two frame and then you do like a clap test, you'll find it's much more closely in sync than if you have it on a zero frame delay, which is how it comes normally. But you might have to play with this depending on the camera you use. But if you're using Sony, I think it's safe to set it to two. Okay, what else do we have? Let's go over to media. That's pretty standard. Plug your device in there and format it. Time code. Okay, so I don't want to go too deep into time code here because time code is one of those things where if you need it, you look into it, and if you don't need it, I don't want to waste your time with it. But if you enable HDMI timecode and you have it on auto restart for the source over here, then it works kind of like the camera's timer, which I find useful for the type of stuff I do where sometimes I'm just recording one-off clips. That way, I might be able to do a demo here, but if I press record, and as you can see, it starts to time up from zero, and then if I stop recording, it resets back to zero for the next clip. So that's the way I would set it up if you just wanted a basic count up as I record, similar to what the camera would do natively. Okay, next up, date. Obviously, set your date and time. And for this one, I actually recommend checking it somewhat frequently. Not the date so much, but the time, because I do find that the clock drifts a little bit. Let's see. I set this like 2 days ago. It's still on time now, but if I checked it in like 2 weeks, it probably would be off by several minutes. And you want to keep that up because it's easier when you look at your metadata, you're trying to organize your files. You'd rather have an accurate date and time for your files. It'll make it a lot easier to understand, especially if you do multiple clips in a day. You don't want it to say 1 o'clock when you actually shot at 7 o'clock. It'll be harder for you to like organize your storage. Battery, shows your battery life. Atom X, that's if you have modules installed, and info. Okay, now if we go to the monitoring menu, the yellow button, obviously this is where we can turn everything on, you know, like zebras or whatever. But if we hit the menu over here, now there's a few more options. Now we already talked about the monitor one. You can see now that we only have native and LUT because we have the log HDR thing turned off. But we're not limited in any way. We can still record natively, just what the camera sees, or we can put on a monitoring LUT if we want. And that's basically all you should really need unless you're trying to do HDR processing right in the device, which I never try to do. But if you try to do that, then that's what it's for. But all the people that were commenting, I don't think that's what you were trying to do, so leave that thing toggle off. Really trying to drive that point home. And then LUTs, we talked about this a bit, you can load LUTs in here. You can load LUTs just for monitoring, like this one, the Atomos Range Fix, which I included in the description on my previous video, which, so you, first you have to choose the LUT, so now the LUT's chosen, but then you have to go to monitor and then actually tap LUT, and then now you can see it. And display, what do we got here? So the backlight, lift gamma gain. I generally don't monkey with those at all because my goal is usually to try to create a similar image on here as to what I would see on the back screen. And if I change these, then I'm not accomplishing that anymore. And so I think that's pretty much it. I mean, that's the basic operations of this thing. The main hurdle that you guys were facing seems to be that whether to enable that log thing or not, and then the other one was audio. So hopefully between those two bits of instruction there, it should resolve a lot of the issues that you're having. I would say treat the Ninja a lot more simply. I know it seems complicated, but I think you'll have better results if you just approach it with only turn on what you need on and try and get a very similar thing to what's coming out of your camera, because again, that's what it is. It's recording the HDMI in. It's not, you know, a change-em device where you, like, you turn something from standard into log 444, but like that's not what it's gonna do. So don't treat it like that. Treat it basically like a screen recorder, which is what it is, with monitoring tools. I mean, heck, you can plug your PlayStation into this and record that, and you wouldn't be asking the PlayStation, how do I correctly process the log? I mean, so I get how it's confusing because of all the picture profiles on a camera, but just treat this as a basic recorder and it'll produce great results for you. But that's going to be it for me. I hope you found this video entertaining, or at least helpful. And if you did, make sure you leave it the old thumbs up and consider subscribing if you haven't already. But if you did not find this video helpful or entertaining, try setting the playback speed to 75%. All right, I'm done.